Diamond Sutra, Tantra, Zen, and Sex. Tantra is a remedy, Zen is not. Zen is a state when illness has disappeared. And of course, with illness, the remedy too disappears. Once you are cured of your illness, you need not go on carrying the prescription, the bottles, and the medicine with you. You throw it. It goes to the dustbin. Ordinarily, society is against sex. Tantra comes to help humanity to give sex back to humanity. And when sex has been given back, then arises Zen. Zen has no attitude. Zen is pure health. What is the Zen approach towards sex? The Zen people seem to have a neuter gender or a sexual aura about them, as if they are unconcerned about it. And that should be the approach, neither in favor nor against. Zen is unconcerned about sex. They treat sex as anything else. It is part of human life, and that is it. There is no fuss about it. Zen has no attitude about it, and that is the beauty of Zen. Zen is neither in favor nor against sex. To have an attitude means you are still obsessed this way or that way. Both who are against and those in favor of sex are really obsessed with it. An obsession is dependence. Obsession keeps you enslaved. With obsession, you can never attain to freedom and the state beyondness. Humanity is so far engrossed in sex obsession that it cannot envision the state beyond the sex, the ultimate freedom. Somebody is against it, he has an attitude, and someone else is for it, he too has an attitude. And for and against go together like two wheels of the same cart or two sides of the same coin. Both for and against are not enemies, they are friends and partners in this business. Zen has no attitude towards sex. Why should one have an attitude about it? That is the beauty of it. Zen is utterly neutral. Do you have any attitude about water? Do you have any attitude about food? Do you have any attitudes about going to sleep in the night? No, certainly not. Something that is natural and spontaneous, how can there be an attitude about it? And such is the approach of Zen. I know there are mad people who are against it, who have attitudes about these things too. One thinks that one should not sleep more than 5 hours. To them, sleep is a kind of a sin. It is something like a necessary evil. No one should not sleep more than 5 hours. And in India, there are people who think only 3 hours of sleep is necessary. Down the ages, this has been one of the greatest calamities, that people have been worshipping uncreated things and sometimes pathological things even. Then you have an attitude about sleep. There are people who have an attitude about food. To eat this or that. To eat only so much or not more than that is also the problem. They do not listen to the body or to whether the body is hungry or not. They have a certain idea and they impose the idea on the nature. Zen has no attitude about sex. Zen is very simple, is innocent. Zen is childlike. It says there is no need to have any attitudes. Why? Do you have any attitude about sneezing? It is neither sin nor virtue. But the society etiquettes have been imposed. It is a natural phenomenon over which you have no control. A sneeze is semi-autonomous, convulsive expulsion of air from the lungs through the nostrils and mouth. It is usually caused by foreign particles irritating the nasal mucosa. Sneezing can also be triggered through sudden exposure to bright light, a particular full stomach, or other reasons. Sneezing is an adaptive reflex because it expels mucus containing foreign particles or irritants and cleanse the nasal cavity. During a sneeze, the soft palate and vulva depress while the back of the tongue elevates to partially close the passage of the mouth so that the air ejected from the lungs may be expelled through the nostrils. Because the closing of the mouth is partial, a considerable amount of this air is usually also expelled from the mouth. The force and the extent of the expulsion of the air through the nose varies. You do not have any attitude towards these. There are men who are against sneezing, and whenever they sneeze, they immediately repeat a mantra to protect him. These people think that when you sneeze, the soul goes out. In the sneeze, the soul goes out, and if you do not remember God, it may not come back. So you have to remember. You have to immediately remember so that soul is given back. It is also believed that if you die sneezing, you will certainly go to hell. You can have attitudes about anything. Once you have attitude, your innocence is destroyed. And those attitudes starts controlling you. Zen is neither for anything nor against anything. Zen says whatsoever is, it is ordinary and good. To be ordinary or to be a no one or to be a nothingness or to be without any ideology or to be without character or to be characterless, nothing matters indeed. Character implies living with the past. It means you are yoked to the past and the future, the two non-existences. When you have a character, you have some kind of neurosis. Character means something has become fixed in you and you act accordingly. Character implies your past. Character means conditioning and cultivation. When you have a character, you are imprisoned in it. You are no more free. When you have a character, you have armor around yourself, you are no more a free person. You are carrying your prison around you. It is a very subtle presence. A real man will be characterless. A Buddha is characterless because he is now here. The moment you are now here, you are not living with the past. There are no more conditionings in him. He is totally free of the past impressions and conditionings. What do I mean when I say he will be characterless? Indeed, he will be free of the past. To be characterless means free of the past. He will act in the moment according to the moment and according to the need of the moment. He will be spontaneous. Only such a person can be spontaneous. He will not look back into the memories for what to do. Character means you have to look into the past and act according to your scriptures, how you have to act in this particular situation. On the contrary, Buddha's situation is different. When a situation arises, you look into the memory, the past, then you have a character. Then you are inquiring from your past, what should I do? When you do not have any character, you simply look into the situation and the situation decides what has to be done. Then it is spontaneous and there is response and not reaction. Thus all enlightened ones and your incarnations, Ram, Krishna, Buddha, Mahabir, Ramakrishna, Raman, Kabir, Jesus, Krishnamurtis are all free from past memories and there is no past conditionings. They are totally free of the past and the future. To them this very moment is eternal and total. All that is sublime happens only in this very moment. Love happens now, flower blossoms now. Now here is eternal and therefore sublime. They have no conditioned character. Hence they are characterless, free from any conditionings. And this state is total freedom. A man of character is not free. He is very tense. He is always concerned with how to act in a particular situation. Zen has no belief system about anything, and this also includes sex. Zen says nothing about it, and that should be the ultimate thing. Tantra has an attitude about sex because it tries to redress what the society has done. Tantra is medical and therapeutic. The society has repressed sex. Tantra means comes as a remedy to help you redress the balance. You have leaned too much to the left. Tantra comes to help you to lean towards the right and to redress the balance. Sometimes you have to lean too much to the right. Only then the balance is regained. Have you not seen a tightrope walker? He carries a staff in his hand to keep the balance. If he feels he is leaning too much to the left, he immediately starts leaning to the right. Then again he feels that now he has leaned too much to the right. He starts leaning towards the left. And this is how he keeps himself in the middle. Tantra is a remedy or a therapy. The society has created a repressive mind or a life negative mind or an anti-joy mind. The society is very much against sex. Why is the society so much against this sex? It is so if you allow people sexual pleasures, you cannot transform them into slaves. It is impossible. A joyous person cannot be made a slave. That is the only trick. Only sad people can be turned into slaves. A joyous person is free. He has a kind of independence to him. You cannot recruit joyous people for war. It is totally impossible. Why should they go to war? But if a person has repressed his sexuality, he is ready to go to the war. He is eager to go to the war because he has not been able to enjoy life. He has become incapable of enjoying. As a result, he has become incapable of creativity. Now he can do only one thing, he can destroy. All his energies have become poisonous and destructive. He is ready to go to the war. He is not only ready, instead he is hankering for it as well. He wants to kill and destroy. In fact, while destroying human beings, he will have a vicarious joy of penetrating. That penetrating could have been in love and would have been beautiful. When you penetrate a woman's body in love, it is one thing, it is spiritual. And when things go wrong and you penetrate somebody's body with a sword or a spear, it is ugly, violent, destructive. But you are searching for a substitute for penetration. If society is allowed total freedom about joy, nobody will be destructive. People who can love beautifully are never destructive. And people who can love beautifully and have a joy of life will not be competitive either. These are the problems. This is why primitive people are not so competitive. They enjoy their life. Who bothers to have a bigger house? Who bothers to have a bigger bank balance, and for what? You are happy with your woman and with your man, and you are having a dance of life. Who wants to sit in the marketplace for hours and hours, day in and day out, year in and year out, hoping that in the end you will have a big bank balance and then you can retire and enjoy? That day never comes. You cannot come. It cannot come because the whole life you remain an ascetic. Remember, business people are ascetic. They have developed something. They have devoted everything to the money. Now a man who knows love and has known the thrills of love and the ecstasy of it will not be competitive. He will be happy if he can get his bread daily. That is the meaning of Jesus' prayer. Give us our daily bread. This is more than enough. Now Jesus looks foolish. He could have said, give us a bigger bank balance. He asked only for daily bread. A joyous man never asks for more than that. The joy is so fulfilling. It is only unfulfilled ones who are competitive because they think life is not here. Instead, it is there. I have to reach to the capital city and become the president, or to the White House to become this or that. I have to go there. Joy is there. Because they know here there is no joy. So they are always on the go. They are always on the go and never reach. The man who knows the joy is here. Why should he be going to the capital city and for what? He is utterly happy here now. His needs are very small. He has no desires. He has needs certainly, but no desires. All needs can be fulfilled, but not desires. Needs are natural and desires are perverted. Now this whole society depends on one thing, and that is sexual repression. Otherwise the economy will be destroyed. War will disappear, and with this the whole war machinery too, and the politics will become meaningless, and the politicians will no longer be important. Money will not have value if people are allowed to love. Because when they are not allowed to love, money becomes the substitute. Money becomes their love. So there is a substitute. And this strategy is subtle. Sex has to be repressed, otherwise this whole structure of the society will fall immediately. Only love released into the world will bring revolution. Communism, fascism, and capitalism all have failed. All isms have failed because deep down they are all sex repressive. On that point, there is no difference. There is no difference between Washington and Moscow, Beijing and Delhi. There is no difference at all. They all agree upon one thing, that sex has to be controlled. That people are not to be allowed to have innocent joy in sex. Tantra is a remedy to restore the balance. So it emphasizes sex too much. The so-called religions say sex is sin. Tantra says sex is the only sacred phenomenon. Tantra says sex is the only sacred phenomenon. Tantra is a remedy. Zen is not a remedy. Zen is the state when illness has disappeared, and of course, with illness the remedy too disappears.